So if anyone has any comments, suggestions, you could just stop me along the way. Contributions, I think that would be nice. So we're looking at chapter two, probability theory. I think some of the learning objectives that I was able to get were to review some basic concepts of probability theory and demonstrate how they can be applied using R, to be able to compute descriptive measures and a variety of probability distributions using the stats package in base R. Also how to draw random numbers, how to compute densities, probabilities, quintiles and alike. And also they discuss some key distributions that are relevant to in econometrics, like the normal distribution, the chi-square, the F-statistics and the like. Yeah, so random variables and probability distributions, some basic concepts of probability theory, the an outcome, mutually exclusive results of a random process, where a mutually exclusive event, only one outcome can be observed. You know, we cannot observe both outcomes at the same time. The probability is like the proportion that an outcome occurs in the long run. Like if in the long run, meaning if the experiment is repeated a number of times. The sample space, a set of all possible outcomes of a random variable. The event is the subset of the sample space consisting of one or more outcomes. The random variable, a numerical summary of random outcomes. That's a random variable. And the random variable could be either discrete or continuous. A discrete random variable has discrete outcomes. Example of rolling a die, the possible outcomes are finite, is from 1 to 6. And a continuous random variable can take on continuum of possible values. Example, the height of a person, it can take any value in a certain interval. Yeah, and then we look at probability distributions of discrete random variables. Discrete random variable takes on, we've discussed this. The probability distribution of a discrete random variable is the list of all possible values of the variable and their probabilities sum up to one. The cumulative probability distribution function gives the probability that the random variable is less than or equal to a particular value. Like the, for example, we can use the sample function in R to stimulate a die roll and generate a set of outcomes. Like if we simulate a die roll, the sample is from 1 to 6, and the size is, we just roll the die once. And this simulation will give us different values, but it will be from 1 to 6. It could be 2, 3, 4, but it will be from 1 to 6. We can also plot both the probability distribution and cumulative probability distributions using R. To plot the probability distribution, we can use the plot function with a vector of probabilities generated by the rep function. And we could do this using this command, which seems to be pretty straightforward. And then we'll have something like this. And since this is equally likely, we can see that all the events have like an equally likelihood of occurring. To plot the cumulative probability distribution, we can use the cum sum function to compute the cumulative sums of the probability vector and then plot it using the plot. And we could see the cumulative, it's like a summation of all the outcomes. Like that's the first outcome, we add it to the second like that, and the maximum will be one. Yeah, I don't know, maybe something. Yeah, I think Kim is writing something in the chat, Helen. I don't know. Oh, yeah, like when we connect these points. What line will it be? Yeah, let me go back. Like here, when we connect these points, so he's asking if we should connect these points, what line will it be? Let's see. A step shape, like a spike?
No, I'm thinking it would be a step function, you know. So, because so basically the set of possible outcomes is either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, and nothing in between. So it would just be a step function, right?
Yeah, a step function. Oh, that's a good point. I wasn't aware of that.
I don't know. It's
yeah, I think that's it. Yeah. So we look at the Bernoulli trials. It's like a discrete a single success or failure experiment is also called a Bernoulli trial or experiment. It's a special case of the binomial where n is equals to 1. So when n is more than 1, then we have the binomial case. But when it's equals to 1, that's a Bernoulli sort of distribution. In general, if the random variable x follows a binomial distribution with parameters and is a member of the n, and probabilities are between 0 and 1, we write that x follows a binomial with np. The probability of getting exactly k success in n independent Bernoulli trials is given by the probability mass function, which is this, where k is the number of success, and it's from 0 to n. And this is the binomial coefficient, which sort of gives it the name, the binomial distribution. Yeah, and if there are any other comments one wants to make on this. Yeah. Yeah, and the results of a single coin toss is a Bernoulli distributed random variable, i.e. random variable with two possible outcomes, that's a head or a tail. Like this, we could also do this simulation in R. The number of success in a Bernoulli experiment follows a binomial distribution. We've mentioned this. In R, we can use the binom function to calculate the probability of observing a certain number of success in a binomial experiment. For example, probability of observing 5 heads when flipping a coin 10 times is approximately 0.246. So we could do this in R by just using the binom function, which is pretty straightforward. And I can imagine if we wanted to do this manually, it might be something else. Yeah, the probability distribution of a discrete random variable is nothing but a list of all possible outcomes that can occur and their respective probabilities. Like in the example of the tossing of a coin, we have 11 possible outcomes for K. And the first key concept, the key concept 2.1, expected value and the mean, which we'll use sort of interchangeably. It's sort of the suppose the random variable y takes on possible values, y1 up to yk, where y1 denotes the first and up to the n, and the probability that y takes on y1 is p1 and henceforth and so forth. The expected value of y, written as expected value of y, is defined as expected value of y is y1 times p1 plus y2 times p1 plus yk times pk. It's sort of the summation of the yi's and the pi is the expected value, where this denotes the summation. The expected value of y is also called the mean of y or expectation of y, and depends on the mu of, and it's denoted by mu of y. The example in our example where we toasted the coin, we had the expected value being like 3.5. And in R, we can use the mean function to do this. But it mentioned something interesting that, you know, we could use the set.sift to function to generate random numbers that sort of help us to be able to reproduce our results in R. So this this was an example where he used the first he set the seat to one. And the main intuition is, or the main argument here is, this helps us to be able to reproduce our results easily. Yeah, I think this mean will be dealt with more later in the book, I think. Yeah, also the variance, the key concept 2.2, the variance of a discrete random variable y is denoted by the sigma square y. It's this. It's just the expected value of the expected value of the square of the random variable y minus the mu of y, which is like the summation of yi minus mu of y all squared times the p of I. So this is the population mean. The variance as defined in key concept 2.2 being a population quantity is not implemented as a R function, as a function in R. Instead, we have the function, the var function, which computes the sample like variance. The sample the sample variance measures how the observation in the sample are dispersed around the sample mean, whilst the population variance, I'm writing mean, it should be variance, measures the dispersion of the whole population. That's the main difference. Yeah, and any, if one has any comments or questions, because I, you know. Now we look at continuous random variables. The probability distribution of a continuous random variable is summarized by its probability density function, the PDF, and the CDF is the same as in the discrete case. The probabilities, expected value, and variance of a continuous random variable. Let fy of y denotes the PDF of y. So this is the PDF of y. The probability that y falls between a and b, where a is less than b, is sort of the integral, is the integral from a to b, the PDF of y, the PDF of y integrated with respect to y. Where the integral is, the integral equates to one. So it cannot be more than one. For the discrete case, the expected value of y is the probability weighted average of its values. Due to continuity, we use integral instead of the sum in the continuous case. And the expected value is the mean of y, which is like the y times the, which is the integral of y times the PDF of y with respect to y. And the variance is basically, it's just the same as in the discrete case, only that here we have to work with integrals because of the fact that we are dealing with a continuous case. Although there's a wide variety of distributions, the ones most encountered in econometrics are the normal, the chi-squared, the student t, and the f distribution. So for some core R functions, discuss also some core R functions to do calculations involving densities, probabilities, and the quintiles of these distributions. So like the four prefixes we should be like familiar with in every distribution is like the D, which is the density, which is like the D norm. When we are looking at the normal distribution, it will be the D norm. And also we have the P, which is the probability, and the Q, the quintile, and the R for random, like random number generation. Thus, for the normal distribution case, the R functions are the D norm, the P norm, the Q norm, and the R norm. And basically, almost any computation we want to do for the normal distribution case, these four prefixes will be able to use them to compute. Yeah, we'll look at the normal distribution. The normal distribution is asymmetric and bell-shaped. The probability density function of the normal distribution is distributed like n with mean mu and variance sigma square. And the distribution is this. That's the distribution. For the standard normal, z, we have the standard normal case, we have the mean is equal to zero and the variance is equals to one. And usually it's denoted by, is it phi or phi? And the standard normal CDF is denoted by the capital phi, something like this. So we know that the PDF is the first derivative of the CDF. Thus, in order to compute the PDF from a continuous random variable, we simply take the first derivative of the CDF. And we could plot this in R to see how the standard normal normal density function looks like it's bell-shaped. And the cumulative density, which is like the step function we mentioned previously, it's like this. We could use R to calculate the probability of events associated with a standard normal variate. For example, if we want to find the probability of Z, probability that Z is less than 1.337, we could do this using the table, you know, the distributions of usually having statistic textbooks, but this could be a bit time consuming. And, you know, in R, it's very straightforward. We just use the P norm, and then it gives us the probability. So which I think in a sense makes life much more easier. Yeah. The 95% probability mass of a standard normal lies between minus 1.96 to 1.96, which is a very useful result in econometrics because we use it especially in when we are doing hypothesis testing and the likes. That is in a distance of about two standard deviations to the mean. We could confirm this by just calculating this, finding this probability. The probability that minus 1.96 is less than or equals to Z, and that's less than or equals to 1.96, which is just one minus the two times the probability of Z is less than or equals to 1.96. We are able to do this because of the symmetry of the standard normal PDF. That's why we are able to do this. And in R, we can easily compute this and it gives us the 95%. Yeah, any comments, contribution up to this point? I think we might come across these concepts again, especially when we are talking about hypothesis testing. Computing probabilities involving normal random variables. Computing probabilities involving normal random variables, the key concept 2.4. Suppose Y is a normally distributed, with mean mu and variance sigma square. Then Y is standardized by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation, which is the Z score. Yeah, which is the Z score. Let C1 and C2 denote two numbers whereby C1 is less than C2. And further, D1 is equals to C1 minus mu divided, sort of standardizing both D1 and D2. Like the probability of Y is less than C2, it's just equals to Z less than or equals to D2, which we could call the phi of D2. And the probability of Y greater than C1, that's one minus. that, 1 minus the phi of d1. So the, if we want to find the probability of c1 less than or equals to y less than or equals to c2, it's just the phi of d2 minus d1. Yeah. Yeah, Kim, I saying, why do we need to, is it? Why do we need standard values? Any thoughts? Yeah, I think that's a good point. Any thoughts on that? I'm thinking maybe, you know, because, you know, if I were to work with the, yeah, z score is a way of standardizing the raw values. Yeah.
I think that g score is that formula is a kind of a way of standardize the raw values. So I think that maybe instead of try to familiar with the formula, we also have to thinking about why we have to use these things in our statistical analysis.
Yeah,
I think that mm-hmm. the reason why I personally think that based on my experience, one of the reasons why we need to use the z-score is because
mm-hmm.
z-score is actually value without any dimension, so there is no unit related to that, because it's just kind of a measure of the how far
mm-hmm.
was the value from the mean depending on the distribution. So that means actually if we have some maybe five or six different column as a dependent variable with the z-score, in that case we can easily compare with those variables, even if those variables is totally different characteristics, you know. So even if their measurement unit is different,
mm-hmm.
but by converting those low value into the z-score, we can compare the relative distribution characteristics across the other independent variables. So sometimes we have to use the z-score to compare when we need to compare across the different variables in our statistical analysis. That's what I thought. So yeah, just kind of for your reference.
Yeah, that's a good point, you know. And yeah, I think that's a good contribution. Also, like like when it's standardized, it's easy to compare the relative Yeah, any thoughts on that? Yeah, and it also mentioned that the normal distribution has some very remarkable features. It mentions that for two jointly normally distributed variables, x and y, the conditional expectation function is linear. And so it's using this to prove this. Yeah, it says that, and then, you know, in the book, there is this widget that it uses to show how this linearity works. And also any linear combination of a set of IID normal random variables also follows a normal distribution. Yeah, the chi-square distribution. Look at that quickly. It's often the chi-square distribution is often needed when testing hypotheses, when testing special hypotheses of special types of hypotheses frequently encountered dealing with regressions. The sum of m squared independent standard normal distribution, independent standard normally distributed random variables follow a chi square with m degrees of freedom, which is like the number of random variables being summed, where like z1 square plus z2 square plus up to m zm square, like the summation of the z square m's, it's distributed as a chi square with m degrees of freedom. A chi-square distributed random variable with m degrees of freedom has expectation m, a mode at m minus 2 for m greater than 2 and the variance of 2. The code below, we can display the PDF and the CDF of a chi-square with three degrees of freedom random variable in a single plot. Like this, we have the PDF. Like that's the PDF, and that's the CDF. Yeah. Yeah, and the outcome of a chi square m distributed random variable are always positive. The support of the related PDF and CDF is sort of all non-negative real numbers. Yeah, any thoughts on this? Because I was this idea of the support of the PDF CDF. What any idea on that? And also in the book, it shows that the expectation and variance depend solely on the degrees of freedom. But it shows in the book, I didn't include that plot here, but it shows that increasing the degrees of freedom shifts the distribution to the right. That is, the mode becomes larger and the and increases the dispersion, like the variance grows. And I didn't include that plot. I think, yeah, let me switch to that. Yeah, I think it's this plot. As we increase the degrees of freedom, we can see the distribution moves to the right and increases the dispersion, like the distribution's variance grow. These are the degrees of freedom. Yeah, that's also a good point. It's very close to the normal distribution when M increases. Yeah. That's a good point. Thanks, Kim. I guess I forgot to capture that. Yeah. The student t distribution, the let z be a standard normal variate, w a chi square m random variable, and further assume that z and w are independent, then it holds that like z divided by the square root of w over m is sort of approximates to a chi square with m degrees of freedom. X follows a student approximates to a student t distribution. X follows a student t distribution or simply student distribution with m degrees of freedom. Similar to a chi square m distribution, the shape of the student t distribution depends on m, i.e. the degrees of freedom. We could also let us plot some t distributions with different m and compare them to the standard normal.
Sorry,
we could see
before.
Yeah.
Excuse me for interrupting. No, so did you clear the?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. I wasn't really. So I was actually waiting when you made the comment about the support.
Yeah.
Do you know what this is?
No, I don't. I don't. So I was like, you know, I didn't.
Oh,
I didn't.
So basically the support, if I'm not very wrong, I think is it's basically the, you know, the you could say the set of outcomes over which the PDF has a non-zero value. Right?
Yeah.
In a sense, you could think of it as the set of outcomes for which there is a positive probability of occurring. If you think about if you think about a discrete distribution and so on. So I think there was a sorry, can you go back to the previous slide?
Yeah.
Okay, so it did say
yeah. It said something, yeah. The support right. Of it is yeah.
Right. So it's a set of positive real numbers, right? Because think about it. You're basically taking a square, a sum of squares,
mm-hmm.
right? A sum of squares of random variables,
mm-hmm.
right? So each component of this sum
mm-hmm.
is either zero or positive, right? Because you're basically squaring real numbers.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Right, and also on the second point, where it talks about the expectation depending solely on the degrees of freedom, it's actually pretty straightforward, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because think about it, if you had to sum, so imagine you wrote, I don't have a pen, but imagine you had the expectation E
mm-hmm.
of Z1 square plus Z2 square plus Zn blah, 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 plus Zm square,
mm-hmm.
right? Since the expectation function is a linear operator.
Yeah.
It's basically the same as the expectation of Z1 square plus the expectation of Z2 square, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Right. And as well, so since each Z mm-hmm. is a standard normal.
Yeah.
Right. So basically you have a mean of zero.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So the expectation of Z1 square is essentially the variance. Right, because you can basically write it as, it's the same as writing the expectation of Z1 minus zero whole square, where zero is and that's one.
Yeah.
So it's like one plus one plus one plus one plus one n times.
Yeah. That's especially the support point is very clear because I was reading and I didn't get that. Thanks.
Right.
So we could see for the student T as well. When we plot using different degrees of freedom, we can see that as we increase the degrees of freedom, it almost approximates to a standard normal. And we could see how the m equals to 25 almost exactly aligns with the standard normal. The F distribution with M and N degrees of freedom is a distribution of W divided by the numerator degrees of freedom and all over V divided by the denominator degree of freedom. It's distributed as a F with M and N degrees of freedom, where W and V are all chi-squared, distributed. Yeah. Yeah, by definition, here also the supports are also greater than, are all real numbers greater than zero. Yeah, if any comments or something. Kim, I guess then you could take over the second part.
Yes, I can. Yeah, I can do that.
Let me stop sharing. Yeah, stop.
Yeah, because I'm not familiar with the GitHub kind of presentation slides, so I'm going to share the screenshot of the
book. Yeah, that's anyhow you do it is fine.
Yeah, so everyone can see the screenshots.
Sure, I can.
Yeah. So is it the font size is good for you, or do you want me to make it larger? This
is the good. Yeah, I think is it good? I think this is fine.
Okay. So in the second part, actually this book is a kind of like a very, I personally think that the concept about the probability theory or just kind of statistical theory things is a little bit explained a little bit poorly. But the thing is, I just try to do my best to explain these things. So in the second part is kind of like a random sampling and then some kind of averages kind of stuff. So in here is actually have an example of the rolling the dice. So maybe, for example, if we can rolling the dice for the n times, it then means maybe each outcome, maybe 1 through n, gonna be characterized by the same distribution, because maybe if we can run the dice, we anyhow we can get the 1 through 6 kind of as a value. And also each probability is kind of like a like a 1 divided by 6, like a 6 of 1, 6 out of 1 out of 6. So that means we already know the some kind of fixed probability, and then we also know the what kind of possible value we can draw from the dice. So that means we can characterize, we can say about each outcome can be characterized by the same distribution. And then, but the thing is that we actually have those outcomes going to be randomly. So that's actually what we call the random variables, because we don't know what kind of outcome we will have when we keep rolling the dice a couple of times or keep repeating those kind of process. That's the reason why our outcome gonna be selected very random. And then furthermore, actually each observation is a very drawn for the same population, because that's what I'm talking about here is 1 through 6 as a sample space. And with the same probability of the each component, each element, events, I mean. So that means we can also say this outcome gonna be identically distributed. At the same time, each outcome does not provide any information or any interaction with the other outcome. So that means even if we get the Y1 outcome, this one cannot affect anything about the Y2. So that means each outcome is highly independent. So combine those two together, we can say outcome gonna be the independently and identically distributed. That is the IID, and then that's the key concept is the 2.5. And then in here, it asks about what happens. We consider the function of the sample data. So that means maybe if we rolling the dice 2 times, then might be that there is a lot of possible pairs, as you can see here. Cause we have the reason why we can do the 36 is we can try rolling the dice first. And then second, so we can get the 6 value in the first, second value also 6, so multiply by 6, gonna be 36. And then those are the possible pairs. And assuming that we can try to get the sum of the each pairs like this, we can get our sample space gonna be like this. So 6 plus 6 is 12, and then 1 plus 1 equals 2. So we have these kind of possible values when we rolling the dice twice. So these are the actually we can say about the possible outcome for the YI. And then enumeration of the outcome fields means what this means is when we try to multiply and when we try to sum up these pairs, that sum gonna be 2 is we only have this pair, right? So 1 plus 1 is 2. So that is 1 out of 36. So in the same way, we can calculate all of these things. And then how we can calculate about the expectation for this probability sample space is like we talked about in the previous sections, it is actually like a PI multiplied by WI, which is the weight. So the weight is kind of like these 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is gonna be the weight, WI, and these are the PI. So when we can do this is 31 out of 36 multiplied by 2, 36, 2 multiplied by 3, etc. And then 36 multiplied by 12. When we calculate all of these things, it becomes 7. That's how these are calculated. And then as you can see here, when they learn this sum of these things, like a weight, these are the weighted average, it becomes 7. And then when we're looking at the variances, like S minus our average and square multiplied by PI gonna be give us our variance, how this part is gonna be. Everyone understand so far, any questions or? Okay, so when we draw this kind of a plus, it is kind of like a look like this, because it is very interesting, because when we try to rolling the single dice, in each value in here is the same, because the thing is, it's one out of six for all of this. So this is what is called a uniform distribution. Right. So when we try to draw this for the CDF, it look like this. So it look like this. It's kind of a spike way of accumulation. And then when we think of the sum of the dice row, we can get what is called the 11 possible sample space value, because when we go up to the top, when we try to think of these kind of pairs and then with the sum, these are our possible value as a sample space outcome. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So we have 11 values. So in bottom actually does not clearly mention what the value is about. So this is gonna be the 2 and this is the 12. So, and then some of the rice row gonna be we have a whole different kind of a probability as a frequency of those sample space that outcome gonna be drawn. So this is more like a normal distribution function. So that's the thing. So and then we can say these are the kind of a sample kind of a spaces from our sample data. So sample average of the sample and observation, because we actually draw the n times kind of outcome from our hypothetical population size in case of the rolling the dice. So actually y bar is one divided by n sigma 1 through n to the yi. So it is just kind of literally we know about how we can call the average, calculate the average. So but the thing is that these are for the sample population. So we can say about this is the sample mean. So y bar is the sample mean. And then I think that the how we can symbolize the population mean for the mathematical symbol like this. I think this is the population mean for that. So anyway. And then the mean or the variance of the sample mean is also the same thing when we try to do the population mean or mean and variance. So it's the expectation of the y bar is the same for the this, and then we can get the mu y because this one is actually kind of like a probability, sum of all of the probability it becomes actually mu y and mu y. So that's actually remove the this end and then we can get the mu y. And then the variance is kind of like a n squared, 1 divided by the n squared, and then the covariance is the yi and yj. But the thing is, we actually say that yi is independently identically distributed, which means yi, outcome of the yi does not have any effect to the yj outcome. So that means their covariance between the yi and yj is zero. So everything is gonna be zero in this part. So that's the reason why we only calculate this part and comes to this kind of a calculation result. So, and then standard deviation is just kind of a square of the variance. So it's a root sigma y divided by the rho n gonna be the sample standard deviation. And then when the y is normally distributed, what's the average expected value of the y sampling distribution should be? This one is kind of like what we call the central limit theorem actually come from. So when we say the y bar, when we say the y is normally distributed, we can say the y bar gonna be the mean of the mu y m, and then the standard deviation is the n, variance is the n sigma square y divided by n. So actually when the we have a very large outcome, which is the large sample size, sample mean, or sample mean values, that actually becomes y actually very close to the normal distributions. You know, because in here, even if we have a kind of like a I is 10 times kind of a sampling, it becomes like a normal distribution with a 0 to the 0.1. But it becomes larger, it is going to become 1 to 1, 0 to 1 for the normal distributions. Hold on. Okay, there is a chat screen. Okay. So these are what this one is actually talk about. And then when we plot the density histogram, as you can see here, the sample average gonna be become to the normal distributions, as you can see here. Because it's a kind of a very standardized bell shape with the mean gonna be the zero. And then it's a highly symmetric in the to the right and left. So this is what the normal distribution can be. So of the y bar, which is the sample mean. So that means even outcome value is the normal distributed, its average also gonna be the normal distributed, gonna be the value when the sample is very large. Okay. So that's what this one is about. But the thing is, in here is what this one is talk about is kind of when we try to think about some kind of a chi kind of a distribution for the m degrees of the freedoms in the form of this one, it's just kind of if we have a very small degree of the freedom, the chi square value is kind of like outcome minus y bar square, like a sigma, right? So these kind of deviations gonna become the very highly what is called the skewed kind of values, which is the m is small. The degree of freedom is small. That means this gonna be the highly right skewed, which is we have a long right tail in here. So this is highly skewed into the to the left, a long tail to the right. So in that case, as you can see here, we have this kind of a distribution. But the thing is, when n becomes larger, these graphs gonna be the move this way, and then it's gonna be also close to become these things. And also depending on the n is larger kind of things. Because if n means like a sample size, not the large capital N. N is when is the sample size is larger, it becomes we have a much higher peak like this. Because we have a very high peak of the same mean kind of value gonna be the draw, because it's a normal standardized normal distribution. But n sample size is larger, it becomes very high peak of the distribution with the symmetric. But not the normal distribution, it's a kind of a very symmetric kind of a distribution curves. So that's how this one gonna be do. And then this one actually leads to the what is called the sample limit theorem in the later sections. And then largest approximation and the sampling probability, that's what I just said, is when you have n is like infinity, that's actually close to the population mean. That means we also gonna be have a very, very same population mean distribution, and then the normal kind of distribution kind of things gonna be drawn. So this is a kind of thing. So when we try to get the more sample size, which means we get the more outcome value of the y, it actually converging into the close to the this kind of a main value, which is a 0.5. Because for example, if we have this kind of binomial distribution of like a tossed coin, and then our p p-value gonna be the 0.5, which is the, our mean of the probability values. That means when we increase the our attempts, which is the n, this is the attempts. And then it's gonna become close converging to the this p probabilities for the binomial distributions. Any questions or any thoughts? Okay, so that's the, this one is also the same thing for the plot above. And then central limit theorem is kind of like when we have this outcome is independent identity distribution random variables, and then expectation is sample mean gonna be the close to the population mean, and the bias also the population variance, and then these kind of a value can be also the pretty the same for the this one, because that means it is arbitrarily approximated by the standard normal distribution. So that means even if that means y is the identically independent distributed things, that means it's a standardized value gonna become the normal, and also y bar value also becomes the normal. So that's the kind of central theorem is about. Yeah, here. The first thing is this one. Yeah, so these are the kind of like interaction kind of things. So when we increase the 1,000, it is very small things, but the things is quite the normal kind of size. Yeah, so in this four plus explains the details, more details about the how the density like a mean or a density frequency distribution gonna became normal when we increase the sample size like this. Yeah, so I think this, this might it. So this is the end of the chapter 2, and then we have an exercise. But the thing is, do you have any questions so far or any thoughts?
Yeah, I just typed something in the chat.
What is the regionally large sample size, which is actually already mentioned in the 2.1. So when you scroll down to the T distribution, maybe I think student T distribution, I think this is the T, not the T. Here
is it where it was talking about in check?
Yeah.
One of the T distribution.
Go down
a bit.
Yeah, cause in the book it's a student T distribution here. Okay. In the book in here is this approximation is a regionally favorable variable for the m is 30. So which means we actually degree of the freedom is defined by m minus 2 or m minus 1. So that means m is equal to the 30 is this means we have to have a sample size should be at least 32 to get the good T distribution kind of approximation. Because when we try to do the OLS regressions in R, every time we have a coefficients and then standard error, and also we have a T values and P, right? So to calculate these P values, the T values, we have to have at least the degree of the freedom should be the at least 30. That means assuming that the degree of the freedom is defined as n minus 2, that means our sample size should be at least 32. That's actually rule of the freedom. But the thing is, the rule of the thumb usually say about the sample size should be the more than 50. That's the kind of our safety kind of a threshold based on my experience.
Thanks for the clarification.
Yep. So this is it. And then any questions or any thoughts or anything so far?
Yeah, I think for me that's it. It was good.
Okay. So yeah, now is the 10:03. So I think we have to wrap up, and then I think that we have to decide who's gonna be the chapter 3.
Yeah. But is it necessary to have to discuss the questions or no?
I didn't do the exercise actually, unfortunately.
No, I don't mean now, but maybe next week. I don't know. What are your thoughts on the other guys? I think maybe at least one or two or three. I'm just asking, you know, let's, if it works it.
Actually, chapter 3 is also have a lot of contents in it, so maybe. Yeah, so just anyone who wants to do the chapter 3, that will be fine. Or maybe if you cannot decide it, just please leave your message on the Slack. Yeah, who gonna do the chapter 3?
Yeah, like you mentioned, if I think maybe latest on, if we could give an update latest on Wednesday.
Okay.
Yeah, so that, you know, anyone who wants to do it or even a part of it, you know, if not all, like we did with chapter 2.
Chapter 2 for what?
I mean for chapter 3, maybe even if, let's say, one cannot present all, someone could present half, the first half, and then another person presents the second half.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Muhammad is saying he can do parts of chapter 4. Yeah, so that's chapter 4 for Muhammad, some part of it. Yeah, like you mentioned, Kim, I think what we'll do is from now on to Wednesday, we can just give some update in the Slack.
Yeah so anyone in this room who wants to do the chapter 3, just leave the message on Slack.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thank you all. It was fine. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
Okay, see you next week.
Yeah, see you next week. Ciao.
Ciao, bye-bye.